Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you all for joining us. And we're just letting a few more of our friends and family, and you're either in one of those two categories, friends or family, even if it's your first time. You are all friends and family.
All right. Sounds good. Friends and family. All righty. We're all
set. Okay. All right, everyone, and thank you all for joining us on this Memorial Day weekend. And I'm trying to like make certain that everybody is in. I think so. And as folks come along, I'll just okay. So there goes GR right there. Okay. And if we could just ask everyone to mute your microphones, that would be excellent. Please just mute your mics so that we can keep down the background interference. All right. Okay.
All right, we're ready to go?
All right, everybody. Again, thank you for joining us on this Memorial Day weekend. I know everybody has big plans to get out and about and get out on the town today. Kidding.
Something like that, right?
Yeah, something like that. But thank you for joining us for this fifth installment of Studio Visit, which is a quarantine project that my buddy Phil Harvey and myself have taken upon ourselves to do over this period of time when we've all been quarantined and in the house over these last couple of months. And I am so excited today to be able to introduce to you all someone who I have a lot of admiration for. I have a lot of admiration for the N’Namdi family, and this gentleman is like a brother to me. I view him as my brother, and I view his family as my family. And so it's my sheer delight to be able to read the short form of his bio. And Phil, you did tell me don't read the whole thing. So
it was a little dry just to read the bio statement. I think that's what they know, Jumaane, what's happening here. Yeah.
But I'll just read a couple of paragraphs because I want to just get some of the essential elements of it. And so here we go. Jumaane N’Namdi is the director of the N’Namdi Contemporary Miami and N’Namdi Contemporary Chicago Gallery. It was introduced to the professional art world at the age of 6. It was at this time in 1981 when his father George founded the GR N’Namdi Gallery in Detroit. He was reared in the gallery business amid an extensive family art collection. Jumaane developed his innate appreciation during his time and his understanding of the interrelationship of art, the artist, and the art collector. Upon graduation from Morehouse College in 1987, Jumaane began his formal career in the arts at what was the burgeoning GR N’Namdi Gallery, Chicago. His discerning eye began to distinguish great pieces from good ones, making it possible for his art patrons to meet world-renowned artists and to develop some of the country's most prestigious art collections. While under his father's tutelage, Jumaane quickly assumed directorship of the gallery and subsequently the GR N’Namdi Gallery of New York. Continuing to forge ahead, Jumaane opened N’Namdi Contemporary Miami and N’Namdi Contemporary Chicago. He continues to uphold the artistic standards of the master artists he has exhibited in the past while expanding the gallery's roster, making the N’Namdi Contemporary a home for renowned and cutting edge international artists. And I just want to say that in my conversations with Jumaane most recently and all the time, we always have really great conversations. Jumaane is truly nutrient rich when it comes to cultural discussions. I mean, he has nutrient dense, and has some really unique ways of looking at the world and explaining his views. And I think that we're going to have a really great conversation. And Phil, I'm going to let you, take it away from here and let everybody know who you are and what you do with C3 Arts. And please, after that, introduce Jumaane.
Well, thank you, Drake. And I want to say once again, it's been a pleasure. These last weeks of doing this has been an absolute blast, having a lot of fun. I am Philip Harvey, for those who aren't familiar with me. I am the host and producer of a radio show here in Harlem called C3 Arts Radio. And also, I've been at this for a good almost 30 years or something, working in the arts in some kind of form or fashion. And the best thing about doing that and being having been involved in all this time are the people that you meet and the people that you kind of establish relationships with. The N'Namdi family has been a very strong presence ever since I first started kind of paying attention to this as a kind of field and understanding the history of the arts, and particularly the arts in as it resolves to people of color. The N'Namdi name has been very, very, very prominent. And it's been an excellent opportunity now to get to know Jumaane and hear more about his story and how he has set up this kind of empire in a way, or continue the empire. So should be a great day today. Thank you, Jumaane, for joining us and participating. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. One question I want to jump off with you, Jumaane, is that, and we were talking about this a little bit before, when the family starts this gallery that at first is dedicated to expressionism and expressionistic pieces and this kind of abstract art, it was really a detour in a sense of what the prevailing liking was in the community. What was behind the decision, just in kind of recollecting your father and how things kind of jumped off in the beginning? What was the thinking behind going down this particular path?
Well, what it was is that my father started the gallery in 81, okay? And he was once you are a psychologist, you're always a psychologist. he was a developmental psychologist. So he would actually go sit in people's homes and watch them interact, watch families interact with one another. And one of the things he realized was that he felt African Americans, they're trying to bond, they're trying to get their life, move forward and things like that, but they were missing something. And what he realized was it was that they were missing the connection to their culture. So there was no foundation. Because I'll talk about how, like, other cultures, I mean, if you're, like, Chinese, you can have nothing, but you know you come from something, and it's tangible. It's people who fly from around the world to see your culture. And with African Americans, we didn't even know we were missing that. We just were like, oh, civil rights movement, this. We're trying to, like, move forward and get this equality, not understanding that we had this foundation. So what my father wanted to do was get people to see their culture in the arts, and not only just see it, but preserve it. So he said, well, look, I'm gonna start a gallery so I can get people collecting their culture. So not only do they see it, they're part of the people who are preserving it and keeping it around. And then just the generation after them will have a different kind of pride because they're like, oh, this is me. This is my artist. This is my foundation. And the reason why he did was abstraction as well was because that is African. I mean, Western art is figurative. Like if you go to the Vatican and see their art collection, it's figures everywhere. African art, you may have a sculpture, but that sculpture is going to symbolize things, not necessarily just try to be the likeness of it. Mm-hmm. And on top of that too, it's kind of like jazz. It's like, if you ask a kid today, if you play some jazz, they really probably wouldn't connect it to them as mm-hmm. this is possible through them. They would just think, oh, that's something else, because that's how it's kind of promoted, and that's where, you know, the circles in which it's played, it's usually not around young African-American people just hearing jazz. I mean, so, I mean, if you're an artsy and like everybody here, yeah, you know jazz, is what it's all about. But mm-hmm. a lot of times people don't know these things, so they don't have this sense of ownership of it.
Yeah, sure.
So, and the thing about, so with abstraction, that was one thing, because he was like, this is us. So when you go to these museums, you'll see these artists that my father, every artist was in a museum. But, you know, usually you go to a museum and you feel like that's so disconnected from you. Like, there's no way you can go to the MoMA and say, I want to get one of those paintings by that artist. You just wouldn't even think that that's possible. Mm-hmm. So he was getting these artists, helping people collect the work, preserving their culture, also developing their eye with the abstraction. Because what happens also with abstraction is that once you really can see it, like jazz, you can see the figure differently. You can really appreciate what that piece is all about and not just liken it for just the subject matter.
Yeah.
It's like there's a mother holding a baby. You know, a lot of times you just say, oh, I like that mother holding a baby. It reminds me of me and my mom. But once you develop an eye for art, you can actually look at it and see if it's a really great painting or not. On top of the fact that you might like the picture of the mother holding the baby, but you start to develop your eye, kind of like music. You hear something, you hear Sade, you know it's great music because you know music, and you're like, I know the story's great, but this is also a great song. Sure. I'm maybe full of analogies today. That's kind of an anomaly thing.
It's rare you kind of meet someone who is generationally, you know, deep in the sense, Jumaane. And we know that, we were talking before, you said that you're two generations deep in the sense of working in the arts and kind of cultivating this kind of understanding of the arts, this fostering these relationships. But what are some of the things early in your life that you kind of picked up? Maybe it was even nascent, maybe it wasn't something that was just so clear to you, but you were kind of picking up, you were kind of storing for your future endeavors. Is there anything you could point to that was big in your development that really is associated or tied to what you're doing today that you can remember from your youth?
Well, I mean, from my youth, in terms of just how to look at art, I think one thing is this kind of I mean, I can say I think it's unique, but it may not be. I mean, I don't, because, you know, first of all, let's start with this. When we got into art, if you start thinking about major art collectors, you literally can count them on one hand. Major art collectors back in the 80s, literally one hand. I mean, if there's more, I'll be happy to know, but it's definitely not more than two hands, 10 people that were major art collectors back in the 80s, at least that are known to the public, okay? So when you were getting into art, it wasn't like something where it was so popular, where you got into it honestly, and like, not honestly, but innocently. You just would see the paintings. You developed an eye for it just by being around it. You didn't necessarily, you learn about it, learn about the different artists, because people are still learning about the artists we started with in 81 now. And these are major institutions that are just finding out who the artists are. And then, you know, we've been doing this 40 years, and now they're like, oh, Ed Clark. And I'm like, yeah, I mean, because, you know, I've known Ed Clark for 40 years myself, you know? But so you were able, though, to develop an eye without interference, without anyone telling you how to look at art, how to. So that's helped me a lot, because it's kind of, I won't say easy, but it's fun and it's relaxing for me to look at art without trying to analyze or use things that I've learned, like my what I learned from school or what I learned from other curators or this or that or from visiting museum to help me discern what I'm looking at. It's just kind of like innate. So I'm just like, I got it, I feel it. It's almost like being a musician. Maybe you grew up in a home full of musicians and you just know how to play piano by ear. You just can just touch it. You're like, I don't even know anything else. butt how to just touch the keys and it just start making great sounds. That's all I know. I never had a piano teacher. I never had this. I just listened to my folks play piano and make records every day for my whole life. That's kind of the experience.
So, Jumaane, so I guess a question I have is, your mother having the school and your dad having the gallery, how did both of those kind of come together to help start a pot to get you to this point? Because you had no idea that you were going to be following your father's footsteps.
Yeah, I was going to be a teacher, okay? You know, I thought I was, my mother had to talk at Toledo Schoolhouse, and I loved the school, great school. So I was planning on being a teacher. So I was an education major, like my first, the day before I got to college. And then as soon as I got there, my father said, you know, do psychology, and then you could do a master's in education. So I wasn't thinking the gallery, because I thought the gallery was boring. I liked art. As a kid going to the gallery, I was just like, hey, okay, I'm back here making a frame or doing something like that. And I'm like, this is no action going on, you know? I learned that, okay? That's totally the opposite of what really the deal is, because it's all up in your brain, you know? It's like, you're thinking, it's crazy. But then, you know, I realized that the kids weren't really listening to me. So like I would intern at, not intern, but volunteer at a school and be a teacher's assistant during, when I was at Morehouse, at a grade school there. And I just realized I was a better, like, I guess, quote unquote, mentor or tutor. You know, after school, we can like play football and like study, but not.
Fun guy.
Yeah, I was a fun guy. I was like, this is gonna be stressful trying to teach. I can't teach, like, cause I just never feel like people hear me anyway. So let alone a whole bunch of 5-year-olds, you know, or 10, whatever age they're, you know, it's like, so I don't really know when the shift happened. I always felt art was important for people to have. I never looked at it like a business, because I always in my head had other things I could do if I wanted to make money. Like I was to promote concerts and parties and all that stuff in high school and college. So I was like, I'll get in music. You know, I had offers to work with different labels, but I just always felt art was important. So I remember my senior year, I was a camp counselor, summer camp counselor. And, you know, the lady would give me my check for minimum wage check. And I'm, thank you, you know, this is my check. But at the same time, I was selling her a Jacob Lawrence. And I never correlated, like, I'm getting thousands here and I'm getting my 100 here. But this was my job, the 100. So I was like, yes. And I was like, of course she wants a Jacob Lawrence, so let me do this. But I still never calculated, like, you know, you made more money off that Jacob Lawrence than you did all summer. But it never mattered, because the important thing was she wanted to collect art. So I think maybe around there, my father, I still don't know how, because my father even told me that in the pamphlet for graduation, said what I wanted to do next. I said, I'm gonna go to Chicago and run the gallery. I don't remember writing that.
Right.
I mean, I guess I was just trying to graduate. So I probably pushed out anything that was taking up space from finishing that last class. Like I probably wrote it and say, okay, done. Let me get back to try to graduate. But so, you know, and then also what I do like business though. I like business, I like promoting, I like people being together and being interesting, but I also know the importance of art and feel like it's really important, because that's how I grew up. It wasn't preached to me. It was just the way
it was. Way of life.
Yeah, just kind of like that Chinese person. They're not being taught every day about the Great Wall. I mean, they might be, but you just kind of know. You see it all the time. You're like, yo, this is culture. This is important. So I knew that was important. And I also understood that you didn't want to reinvent the wheel. I always say, don't reinvent the wheel, just put rims on it. Hence why I was going to be a teacher too, because I was like, hey, I'm going to school and keep working there. So both things, but I see all the action at the school. So I'm like, oh yeah, they need me there. There's action. Yeah. And I'm like, oh, he can handle sitting there. And you know, he doesn't need me for that. So deal. So I just went to I did the gallery. And then I moved to Chicago, because at the time, my father has Detroit, and he had Detroit then. And then he opened a gallery in Chicago in 96. So in 97, when I moved to Chicago, I literally just went into the, well, I had another job at Ralph Lauren. My father said, stay there for 6 months. He really just didn't want to have to pay me as soon as I walked in to Chicago. He was like, hey, you know, now I gotta help him get his apartment. I gotta do this. He probably thought all the stuff you do when you first move to a city, but if he's my employer, he gotta help with all that. So he's like, look, you finish working at Polo, 6 months, basically get settled, get those bills down, and then come over. So 6 months later, I came over. And I mean, I literally was thrown into it.
Yeah.
Because there was we had great people there working, but it wasn't even a gallery like that. It was more like a showroom. It was more like, hey, if you go to Chicago, come on by and check out this work. But it wasn't meant to be necessarily like its own entity that's selling art and doing everything. It's more like a just exhibition space.
Jumaane, before we get too far, I think we said, you three of us said yesterday we were going to show one of your videos early up front. So before we get too far down the line, I'm wondering if we can do that just so folks can kind of see where you are now and get a visual aid.
Okay. I'll show the video of my new space in Miami. Does that work for you guys?
Sure, absolutely.
Let's now I'm slow motion with Zoom, just for the record. I'm slow motion with Zoom. This is literally my first. My wife laughs because she's like, this is the first time you got on Zoom all this whole quarantine? I'm like, basically. All right, let me see. Hey, can y'all see my screen?
No. Remember, you have to do share screen and share audio as well.
Yeah, you got to do a disable. The host has to disable the screen sharing.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. Let's do that.
Not my fault. I love it.
Okay, there you go.
All right.
All right.
The labor of love started back when I was a child, back in 1981 when my father first opened his first gallery. So I wanted to start by thanking him for opening the gallery back in 81. So, you know, I started in 97 in Chicago when he opened the second gallery. And, you know, the whole purpose was just to get people like this together, coming out, enjoying the arts, preserving culture. And, you know, I moved to Miami in 2012 because I just wanted a new experience, something different, try something that I thought was interesting. And I got here and I realized it is very interesting. It is great. It's amazing. Wynwood in 2012, and then, you know, 5 years later, we were able to get this building, buy this building from a great guy named Ernest. So I'd like to thank my wife, Lauren, for everything. And you too, Nataki, for being awesome and being inspiration.
Awesome.
That's right, because you know we built this for you, right? But thanks, Mom, though, for your inspiration to say I can do whatever I want to do. I represent Little Haiti. All right, y'all. DJ.
ride.
That was very nice. Just awesome.
Thank you. Appreciate
very
you.
Warming, right? This video.
am I still sharing screen?
No. It's all
good. Okay. I feel like my parents with technology right now.
It was
you know, Jumaane,
I find
it interesting because, you know, like we were talking about jazz before we watched the video, and you know, there's a different culture for each of the cities that has kind of developed around the music or you know, around the jazz culture in that particular city.
Right.
And then you've been dealing with it in different places, Detroit, Chicago, Miami. Do you see a very discernible difference between the cultures that you find that kind of gather around the work in the museum or at the gallery?
Well, you know, it's interesting because, okay, I was in Detroit. I mean, we're in Detroit, but, you know, live there, Chicago, then New York, and here. One thing that was really mesmerizing to me, I mean, it may not seem like a big deal, but the people here were so just like entrenched in the art when they would see it. It's kind of like, and young people, like this was like, and I know we're a group here that loves art. So everybody's here like loves art. So we look at art when we go places. But like, and like the New York Gallery, we'll have receptions. It's packed, people are there. They're talking to each other. They're facing themselves if they're talking, right? And then, even Chicago, everybody, it's like a community space where people are together, which is great. When I was here, random people would, now that could be everybody just kind of knew each other, they want to talk this and the other. But when I was here and I have openings, the young people would come in and they would just hover around the paintings and just stare at them. Right. So even if they're talking, they would have their arms around each other in a long row and just look at the painting and talk about the painting, maybe talk about whatever they want to talk, whatever it was, they faced the painting. It reminds me of when I went to China and, you know, I go to a party and I'm like, the DJ was jamming, so I'm dancing. But I noticed, you know, you dancing for a minute, you look up, no one else, they're moving, but they're not really dancing and they're all facing the DJ. You see it now you see with all this social media, you see, you know, videos maybe of people facing DJ going like this, but literally it was like that, we're watching the performance all the time, so whatever that art form is, everybody's like zoned in. And for me in Miami with so many different cultures, a lot, you know, of course Latin American culture is really strong here. But you also have a strong Haitian community. You have all these different communities. So you drive down the street, you hear Spanish, then it turns to French, and then it turns to just like English from different people based upon where they're from. You know, it was kind of refreshing because long as I've been here, only one person has ever asked me, are these Black artists? I've been 8 years now. That's a normal question for me, especially in New York. In New York, that was all day. Like everybody walked in, black artist. Like, and I'm not talking about African Americans saying it. It's people who will just connect me and say, well, if it's him selling it, then there must be Black. That's funny because now nobody Black sells Black art. But you know, but that was kind of the...
It naturally followed that because you are a Black man.
that's all you would... I don't know. But in Miami... in Miami, they never... That wasn't even a thought. It was always... Yeah. I learned so much also about the artists and what they were doing because a lot of these artists would travel a lot. Like, for instance, one of my artists, Ed Clark, right? Mm-hmm. He always did this one figure that was called a broken rainbow, right? Maybe he even called it broken rainbow, where he kind of had these swoops, right? And matter of fact, now I got to find a broken rainbow. So, but basically the guy comes in and he says, where is this artist from? I'm like, oh, New York, you know. I thought she was waving to me, your mom's. He said, you know, from New York, he said, oh, because that symbol means like, like strong man or something like that. So he saw, and also it was funny because Ed Clark did the piece in Morocco, based, and that was where the guy was from, that area. So he saw these swoops as like, oh, that's a symbol we use. So Ed was getting a symbol from another place, bringing it to his work. He doesn't really know. He just sees the symbol, broken rainbow. He calls it, America calls it broken rainbow. So you got these different people, though, coming from different places in Miami who are also shedding light on what these artists, what they see in the art that came from the artists of during their travels and their experiences. You understand that? You get that?
There's a very... I look at some of the artists that you guys have dealt with over the years, and there's a very interesting kind of dynamic, from, of course, from Ed Clark, the great Ed Clark, onto, the great Charles White. And then you get into this kind of newer generation. Do you see yourself kind of spanning generations in terms of the artists you deal with, from Ed Scott to the Rashid Johnsons and so on? You're kind of... moving through the spectrum, do you see that as part of your overall responsibility and duty to necessarily kind of bring in new generation of artists, not just the consumer or the collector, but also kind of training and molding new artists as they come along?
Yeah, I mean, I find that, everything kind of starts with my father. Some of you are going to hear that a lot. So with my father, his main thing was getting people to understand the value of collecting. I find that nowadays, it's really, I find that a lot of times my job or my, I don't want to say, not necessarily passion, but it's more of a responsibility. My responsibility is to, when I get a moment with artists, young artists, it's really communicating with them the importance of, how do I say this? Okay, the art world has changed so much and it's such a business now that the artists don't get the same freedom that the previous generations had to create. So, because they're successful out of school now, okay? They make money out of school now, okay? They're professional artists, at 23. And before, an artist at 23 got to, finish school if they went, explore different techniques, try different travel, hang with different artists in different parts of the world, do this and the other. No one bought the work, so they were like able to feel free to change up a style or try new things and do all this. Now the artists are so successful so early that you get locked in to whatever you did first. And then on top of that, the galleries make them feel that they are so superior and that they're lucky, the artist is lucky to be here with me, that the artist thinks the gallery knows what they're talking about. The gallery is a business. Those galleries, especially a lot of the galleries today, they're just businesses. Back in the day, those galleries, that may have been your business, but you just appreciated art because you weren't making no money like that. You paid your bills and you just kept pushing art. You, no matter what you were doing, your main goal was to push art. Nowadays, the main goal is to sell art. When you're a young artist and you're going to have certain skills that are just amazing. It's kind of like if you invented Advil. Of course, they're going to say, man, this is great. We're making billions a year off this. Don't change. And let's say you said, no more. I'm done with that. I want to go for curing cancer. I want to go for curing corona. I want to go for all these things. You can't change because you are locked in because you're successful for what they need from you at that moment. This is not free for all to see what else you got. We get somebody else for that who actually comes out the gate with that. So with the young artists, I'm afraid that they don't understand that they really are part of the person who, they are the people who are dictating, like, or not dictating, but writing, I'm, my vocabulary is just like gone, it's zooming out of here. No, but no, so they're the ones who are creating how we are be viewed for the rest of the world as civilization. Like, there's the end of the world, you're only going to go back to look at art to figure out what's going on. Kind of like right now, we only know about the past through the art. No one from the past is sitting there saying, oh yeah, back in 2 BC, this is what happened. No, you look for art, and then somebody figures out what's going on, and that's how you know what happened to the world. People don't understand that what they're creating here is forever. Yeah. They really think it's one generation. They think it's right now. Now, understanding that African-American culture as African-Americans is not that old. It's a few hundred years old. Mm-hmm. That's new. That's young. That's very young when you really think of the grand scheme of how long people have been existing in this world. Yes, we were African, but I'm talking about African-American. Mm-hmm. That's another... things evolve. That's another culture. So it's really important that we allow our young artists to keep pushing and inventing and see where we can go and where we can, what we can continue to create and not get caught into the business aspect of I'm successful. I paint this picture. Everyone loves it. I'm selling out my shows. The gallery, of course, comes back and says, hey, I need another body of work like that. The same thing happened with music. That's why music's so stale. No one here wants their kids to be raised off of the music that's being created today. And if it does raise your kid, you got a problem. No, it's true though, because art is what we look at. This is how we are viewed in the world. This is how we view ourselves through the arts. So when your culture becomes a commodity and the artist become these machines and these manufacturers of whatever the powers that be want them to create, you will stifle not only your growth as an artist, but your growth, but the culture's growth.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because now we don't know what's possible. Because of course, if you come out of school and you make a great painting, of course, because you're a great artist. You're good. You know what you're doing. But don't think that's it.
Like, yeah.
We get caught like this was successful, that's far as I can go. It's like, no. You have to keep on pushing and see what happens, because this is how we're going to, you know, this is our culture.
So Jumaane, so you know, we got about a little more than 15 minutes before we start opening up for everybody to ask questions. So I want to just get through some of your visuals really quickly.
Oh, yeah. Let me show you the video of, because you talk about young artists. Now, I got this young guy, Stephen Arbois, right? And I really like his work. He's works with coffee, and his family's from Haiti. He's a first generation Haitian American. Okay, and what I like about his work is that he is pushing the envelope. Because you kind of talked about like Rashid, like working with him. Like in the beginning, he was making these pieces, and I kept telling him keep evolving, keep changing. That's always been our thing, because we know we want the artists to continue to change and grow and see where they can end up. So now if you go from the beginning, what he was creating, to now, it's totally different, but they're all great. With Stefan, I like him because he is, he continues to grow. Now, Stefan had these works where they were figures, people loved them, and then he went totally abstract, because what you'll see in this video is a lot of collage on the works and things like this texture, because he would take these rags and dab the coffee with them. He wouldn't use a brush. He'll pour the coffee on top of the paper, move it, create the form. From there, take these rags and dab it, mix it with a little acrylic and stuff like that, and just use that to dab. Then he had a whole pile of paper towel in the corner of his studio. And he said, oh, what am I going to do with that? He said, oh, I incorporate back into work, kind of like Ali McGee does with the sticks. It's like everything's a tool, you know? But you got to have freedom to do that. Because if you want to face it, you come back with dabs of paper towel, somebody could say, hey, man, I want the face. I don't want paper towel collage all on the thing. But with his freedom, he's able to express that, like Al Loving did back in the day in the 60s, where he was doing cubes. The gallery loved it, sold out everything. He went back to Detroit to do his next, get ready for his next exhibition. He went to the DIA. He saw a quilt exhibition. Went to his studio, cut up all his cubes that were going to be sold because the gallery's just waiting for him to get back to New York. He cuts them up, starts weaving them together, throws them in a suitcase, goes back to New York. They said, where your work? He's like, here, right here in the suitcase. opens it up, they're like, they fired him, they sued him, and all that. But today, today, those Drake pieces are worth more than the cubes.
Right, yeah.
But see, somebody else will say, man, just stay here with these cubes. We're good. Like, I don't need to take a chance. I don't, it's not, and also, it's not a lot of times in people's, it doesn't behoove them for you to continue to grow. Now, if it's a lot of times personal to you, you want to see the growth. You want to see the experiences. But if it ain't personal to you, you don't even see it. You don't even see the need. You're like, this is fine. Like, whatever you're giving me right now is good. So what Arbois, what I like about him, back to him, what I like about him is that he's a great artist who keeps pushing. And at the same time, he might look like our last exhibition we had right before Corona, matter of fact. I'll say right before Corona, he really, it was nice because like you can see from that grand opening video, the energy, it's like that old school culture, because that's the main thing I want. I just want the culture to be there. And this was just, I mean, this felt, I mean, I wanted to go back to the event, even though I was there. I was like, I want to go back there. And I was like, well, damn, that was my event. So I'm going to show you this. And I guess I'll share screens on, right?
Yeah.
All right, sorry. Now y'all can see my incompetence of moving screens around. Is the audio, you're sharing your computer sound. Okay, good. We'll be right back.
Very nice. Very nice.
Nicely done once again.
But no, what I loved about that was that, see, you all see the gallery whole world is shifting now. Where... Hold on a second. I got something started on my screen. All right. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Oof. By week four, I'll be as soon as this is over with, I'll be like Zoom, and they're like, man, I'm just coming over. I'll be like, damn, I got this. But no, but what I like about this is that there used to be really good homes for people to see African-American art at African-American galleries, with African-American people being there, being welcomed, being collectors, you know, enjoying themselves, not just being not saying it's all like that, but not being the few, kind of like the club, you know, it's like, oh, I can go if I buy a bottle and have a whole lounge, but I just can't walk in and say, hey, Johnny, and walk on in. Like, you know, you have to like be a special case to be there. Mm-hmm. And the whole art world is changing now. And I know, you know, sometimes people are like, oh, you know, everybody should sell the art and be a part of this and that and the other. But it was so important that we had those type of experiences, like the National Black Fine Art Fair, things like that. I mean, that were raised, kids were raised on, hey, every February going to National Black Fine Art Fair, we're going to meet all these different artists, collectors, just people hanging out, seeing things, having accessible galleries, want to sell you the work.
So Jumaane, you touched on this yesterday. You talked about, you kind of made distinguishing, you distinguished the different art scenes in the different cities, you know, Chicago, New York, Detroit, your hometown, Miami, and other places that you've been, that you've actually worked as well as lived. But, you know, so what are some of the things that you've noticed in your travels, in your workings?
Well, I mean, Detroit, Chicago, New York, that was all during the time, that was earlier, you know, like the art world has changed. The art world changed probably back in like, I think, I can't remember the year, maybe it was probably like 2001 or something like that. But it changed when the Studio Museum did Freestyle, the exhibit. Mm. That's when the art world changed.
Okay.
I remember when after that exhibition, because like Rasheed Johnson was in that show, but they had everybody else they kind of found and did that. Rasheed, they called me because they knew, because I put him out there, they knew him, and they want him in the show. So that's how I was connected to that show, you know, as a loaning art. But I realized like right after that, all the art became about race. It became like, I would see nigger and all the work, nigger, da 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 da. Everybody started channeling some pain that they really didn't have. I mean, everybody got issues, everybody got stuff, but you know,
it seemed contrived.
Huh?
It seemed somewhat contrived.
It was contrived, and yeah. Also it was pulled from places that you had other things that were more important to you in your life, you didn't deal with those anymore. You felt like you had to go find this. It's like me. Yeah. Sometimes I see a police car that makes me mad? Yes. Cause I've been pulled over. I've been harassed, blah, 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 blah. But I much rather paint a picture of my daughter because that means so much more to me in my life.
Yeah. Than
that guy. So, you know, we have too much other positive and or just other experiences, period, whether they be positive or negative or whatever it is going to be, but we have so many other things. But those were the experiences that were being promoted, the negative experiences. Mm-hmm. So people started to have to put it in there. Then once that happened, a lot of the joy in that next generation and freedom and art and expression for me started to leave, because that's like the beginning of that post-black stuff, you know. So all that started to leave, and that mainly was a New York, Chicago. I don't think Detroit as much, just because Detroit, it was still just African Americans around each other, so nobody was there to perpetuate it. Mm-hmm. You know, so nobody was there to, you know, if you do something there, they're like, no, nah, I don't like that, man. You know what I mean? It's like, Detroit's that kind of city, you know, yeah. where they just tell you how they feel. So people kind of always have a sense of pride. So they rather paint a D, you know, like, no, man, I'm painting a D. I'm not painting a, you know, why am I going to go negative when I can go do something to promote?
Right.
And then from there, you know, people started feeling obligated to make certain works and then obligated to show certain places. And then what happened is that whole culture kind of just shifted and left. And that's kind of what I saw a little change in the art world, and the joy and the camaraderie and the connection to culture is gone. Because we're really the only culture that you don't get your culture from your culture. I mean, back in the day it was stolen, but then you're like, well, I can't steal anymore because that, you know.
Most of the gatekeepers are not ourselves.
Right. And I think it's all good because there are some people who promote African-American art and they're not African-American, and that's their whole thing because they've been promoting important art forever, right? Mm-hmm. Cool. But what has happened now is that when you don't, when you're not being distributed through your own culture,
mm-hmm.
you don't control what's being distributed anymore and how you're being perceived. Mm-hmm. And no other culture would go for that, except for somehow we've shifted in our head that it's a positive, but it's a negative. It's kind of like, let's give an example. If you go to a museum, right, like a history museum or something like that, and they go from enslavement to now. First, you'll see like some chains, you know, shackles. Then you'll go through, you know, some antebellum years and this, that, and the other. And you'll see enslavement. Then you'll see like, Jim Crow. You got the civil rights, and you go this, and then you got Michael Jordan. You got Oprah, and you're like, oh, great, right? Mm-hmm. So the whole point of that whole thing is how far have we gone away from the shackles? Which makes sense. Hey, man, those were shackles. I don't want to be there again. So I want to be Oprah now, right? But first of all, everybody ain't going to be Oprah, okay? And on top of that, what did they have on their wrist before the shackles? Because if you got jewels on, nice African beading, da-da-da-da-da, they take that off, put the shackles on. Whoever kept those shackles for all those years, I guarantee they got them beadings. Because why would you keep some old rusty shackles but not keep some beautiful jewels, right? But if you don't own those, you can't control them to get into the museum. They can just keep that in their own personal little thing. Now, the difference is if those were able to be there before the shackles, the whole museum has changed its whole scope and this whole thing. Because now, instead of us trying to get to Oprah, we're trying to get back to that. Mm-hmm. And everybody can do that. And you ain't gotta have $1 billion. That's just you seeing that you were somebody first. But you gotta own your own culture to be able to put that stuff out there.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't own your, like, if you don't own the art 100 years from now, somebody could say, you know what? We not showing no black artists no more. Mm-hmm. We're good. And then everybody's gonna say, show our art. And then they're gonna like, well, you show it. You're like, I don't have it. You have it all. Show it. And you're like, there you go. Now you have control of your culture. Same way in the music. They can dictate how we sound the music on TV, movies, theater, any art form, anything that's the preservation of culture for the future, we have no control of to make sure we're always shown. Now, before, you could do the visual arts was the last thing we had, but it was also the most important. Because that's the real stuff they're going to dig up. Mm-hmm. That's where the archaeologists are going. That's what they're going to look for. Mm-hmm. So the visual arts was the last one we had. And the only reason we had that because nobody else wanted it because nobody ever wanted to see an Ed Clark next to a Rothko.
Right.
But now little kids are going to museum.
That's politics, right?
Yeah, see, but that's Clark also that's preservation of their culture.
The, you know, I think it's quite interesting what you're saying, Jumaane, because some people might argue that now is a kind of golden age for Black artists and African artists, you know, in terms of representation, kind of doing well in the auctions. We're seeing these kind of breakaway prices for in the auctions and everything else. But when I listen to you, I'm hearing more, there's still the same issue. So even though there may be more opportunities for Black artists in today's climate and such, maybe it's ephemeral, maybe it's just cyclical, but there still is this question of who owns it and then who's making sure that it gets distributed or seen or what have you, is still being controlled outside of the community. What do you think about that idea?
Let's say this. Let's say, you know, like right now, if you want to see any African art, you go to London, right? Yeah. Let's say back then, instead of taking it, they gave them some money for it. They paid them. Mm-hmm. Okay. Right now, so now you go to London still, you look at it, they own it. Was that money worth it? No, because they still control the whole culture because they have the whole art. And on top of that, there is not technically more opportunities now for Black artists than it was before. Now, there's more opportunities for arts, period, because art is much bigger than it was before. But before, nowadays, a lot of young artists don't get a chance because unless you are that one that's chosen, there's nowhere else for you to go.
There's a very clear pipeline, right? If you go to Disney, you go to Maryland College, you go to Art Institute Chicago, you know, so on and so forth, Yale. And there seems to be a pipeline for you, but if you're not part of that, then you're still, you know, on the outside struggling.
And it's okay. And if you know what you have, if you know what your work is as a culture, you know that people are going to find you no matter what you do. The problem is now, and I hear this a lot from a lot of artists, they go to different galleries and then the gallery doesn't allow them with the freedom to continue to create whatever they want to create. That's one. And then two, the collectors can't get the art anymore. And I challenge anybody here to just go, anybody who's in some major artist that you think, go there and say, I want to buy one. And I guarantee you'll be on a waiting list that would never show up.
I tell you this,
you're talking about money. One last thing. Because you're talking about money in the arts and how people are much more successful, right? Considered successful. Well, people are much more successful in music right now, too, than they ever have been. Does that matter to you that all the people you hear saying B's and H's and kill this and drug use, they're very rich. Is that better for us or not? I mean, it's like this. The Terminex guy came in, you know, he had some ants in the gallery, right? And he said, I said, you're going to kill him? He said, well, you're going to see more because I'm going to put this bait out here. And he said, but what they're going to do is they're going to eat this bait and then they're going to take it back to their nest and everybody else is going to eat the bait because they're going to love it and they're all going to die. Mm-hmm. But you're going to see them living here. So don't kill them because they got to go back to kill everybody else. That's exactly what's happening in our arts and our culture. The bait is the money. So we all see that money like, wow, this is cool. But all it's doing is going back to the nest and killing the whole culture. Because people are going to see, this ain't been a complete generation yet. Okay, these artists ain't got 60 yet. Mm-hmm. These are young people. Mm-hmm. So they haven't gotten older where they can see what the results would be from being stuck in the style, from being basically a trend or a fad, not having control of your life, your art, and not your peers and your culture, not owning your art so that you can go see it. And it can be always, you always know that it's going to be shown in the way you want it to be shown. Mm-hmm. They ain't got there yet. I've been doing this two generations because I grew up in one generation of it and I've been working another generation of it. And I'm seeing how it's changing, how it's going. So all we're doing now with all these auctions and this money and that money, that's all bait to make us go there. Because imagine you making a couple $100,000 in auction. You're young. And then one day you're not relevant anymore, mm-hmm, to them or whoever, because they, and I say them, is that's them are people who collect different types of art, you know, like they're like, oh yeah, today I'm buying Chinese art and Korean art and I'm buying Latin American art and I'm buying African American art. Like it's a trend, it's just what you want. Mm-hmm. It's almost like saying buying photography, maybe buy photography this year, next year you buy sculpture. Our whole culture has been put into a category. Instead of in our culture, we have categories. So this artist who's making a couple hundred thousand dollars, now they're older, maybe their work is kind of, you know, falling off when the auction is not selling as much, so people are just like, whatever. Now they want to come back to their people and say, hey, buy my art. They're like, oh yeah, you're a famous person. Yeah, I am. Now the work is stale because they haven't changed in 40 years. And it's overpriced because they say, why am I going to spend that much money for a piece? Because you, that piece should be $30,000 at the most, because you're doing great stuff, but why am I spending $250,000 for this? Outside of being an investor, it don't make sense when you're a kid, because you ain't, I don't care how great of a painting it is, you ain't did that much to shape and change civilization. Okay, you just haven't. I mean, you can't be, oh, I'm 25 and I just changed the whole culture. No, you have not, because the culture ain't even seen your work, because it's just been being bought up like that. They don't even know you exist. So how the hell did you change it, right? Yeah, and you haven't figured out your own self yet. So
hey, we got some questions. We got some questions from the audience.
Cool.
Yeah. Okay, man. Yeah, y'all flowing, man. But we got some questions, and I think Kathleen has a couple of them. And she goes back to your original statement about what do you think the shift in 2001, she says, following the shift of art 2001, do you think there's been a follow on? You know what?
Hello, Kathleen, let me hear you.
I'm gonna let you ask that question because it doesn't make sense.
I don't think Kathleen's mic works. It's the issue.
Oh. Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, try to read it again. I'll listen clearer.
Okay. She says, you read it, Phil, because maybe you're reading it
different. I don't have access to it, Drake. I haven't seen it.
Following on the shift.
Oh, let me read it. I can read it. Shit.
Yeah, read it.
Right, man. In front of me, yeah. Following on the shift in African American art. Okay. Totally clear, Kathleen. Totally. I'm like, dude, that was totally clear. Like, do I feel like there's a shift back to the kind of abstraction? That's interesting. Just trying to think. All right, first of all, I would say this. When we were showing abstraction and Al Lovey and all them, it wasn't like that was a shift. That was the abstraction was the thing. Okay. It was, and it wasn't even, see, cause it wasn't like a, what are black artists doing today type of situation back then. It was, hey, I'm a figurative painter. I'm a sculptor. I'm a photographer. I'm an abstractionist. I do this. I do plot. Like everybody just did whatever they were doing. And like, that's why I say the National Black Fine Art Fair, we all kind of went there and saw everything. So you got to have these different experiences. One of the things that's happening now is that artists are feeling like they have to think about what they're doing. Like, hey, they have to categorize, they have to make series. And they're young. They like, make a series of work, make this, be structured, do this, that, and the other. And a shift in terms of people recognizing abstraction, I don't know. Because you get a few abstractionists that people kind of follow and think are, yeah, it's categorized and stay stagnant. Yeah, it's categorized and stay stagnant because you want, that's the only way a lot of galleries can work is money, right? So what happens is this, you have, and I'm gonna go back to that, but this is important because you see it all the time with when these galleries start showing these historical, like Ed Clark or Gilliam and people like that. The thing about what happens is the gallery gets their work. They break it down in years, 60, 70, 80, 90, or whatever, right? And then each area is important at that moment. They're like, all the 60s are important until they're sold. And then when they're all sold out, then we go to 70s. Only the 70s are important, people. Don't buy anything but the 70s. Don't buy nothing but this series. Everything has to be structured. And that's not, artists may work in a series, but a lot of times I find that artists don't even, you know, they hear this so much, they don't even know how different things connect still. You don't have to, it's kind of like your clothes, you go shopping, you don't buy outfits. You might, but you only wear that once together. After that, everything is being mixed in together and it still looks cool because it's all you. It's all your vision, your style. And with the artists today, they are having to think like, am I going to be this abstractionist? And am I going to have to do this? The only reason somebody, back to Ed Clark, gets away with like, oh, I throw a 70s out there, I throw an 80s, I throw a 2000. Because when the other gallery started showing him, they can only show what they can get. So it was just kind of like, here it is. So at that point, they had to acknowledge the pieces he did later in his life were relevant. Because normally he wouldn't do that. Normally they say, nope, we're going to start early and just work our way up every decade. But with him, it was like, hey, you might get a piece from 2009. And then it was like, you might get a piece from 1979. So you figure it out. So it became like, okay, he's going to be important every which way. And that's what, so I think in terms of the shift, I don't know. Plus abstractions. See, a lot of these artists may be abstractionists. They just haven't gotten a chance to make abstract work. Because when you learn in school, most artists who are abstractionists can paint a person. Okay, just like Miles Davis can do some classical music. He can, that stuff you learn. You learn that. That's class. Okay, after that, it's about how do you take those notes and change them into notes that don't exist. So an abstractionist, you have to really be a great painter because you got to figure out how to reinvent art, how to reinvent something. You just can't say, well, abstraction is splashing paint or throwing this. It's not. It's like when I, you know, playing piano, if I go boom, 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 I think that's what they're doing, but they're not. They actually can do, Miles Davis can do that same 150 times the same way. Now, if I do it, it's going to sound different every time because I don't know what I just did. So the shift to abstraction will be very hard because a lot of artists don't have time to grow and figure it out. That's why I like the video you saw with Arbois. What I like about him was that he, like this guy came in the gallery and he wanted to buy a couple pieces and he was like, who's this artist? And he was just real snobby, you know what I mean? Like one of those, him, like those investor and art type people. And I don't really like that. You know, I'm like, you got to show me some love. You got to love this stuff. Like I'd rather the lady comes in giving me $100 a month than you coming in here trying to write a check because you are trying to figure out if it's going to flip next year, you know? So he came in and he saw the faces and then he saw the abstraction. He said, oh, so he was doing abstraction. Then he just started drawing faces on top of it. Because they always down it so that way you feel insecure and be like, okay, you can have a half off. I understand, you know? And I'm like, whatever. So I said, no, it's the other way around. He was doing the faces and then he started collaging and now these other pieces are his recent work. And his face just stopped like, that's interesting. But that's really the order in which it goes. But he was like, wow. So he's really making art. He's really trying to like, push the material and evolve. So
yeah,
if we got more freedom in it, you will see a lot more abstractions.
We just got a question from it says my Morehouse brother from Tav Parsons. You seem to be hinting around at the recent white interest in African American art. Can you comment on how their investor style of purchasing is pricing many African American collectors out of the market?
That's such a Morehouse question. Like well, It's a couple things. It's pricing African Americans out because for one, like I said, we're just getting this whole new art wave nipped our we were moving. We were had a stride going in terms of collecting art. Like I said, in the 80s, it was probably about five of us had art. 90s, maybe 15. Now you got more, but you ain't got a lot of people who have collections. Now this whole new generation, and those are all people who would be 60 older now. This new generation can't get to art. So right when we figured out, wow, this is great. Cause before, you know, we had the Maslow hierarchy of needs. So everybody want the car, they want this, they want all this. I know GR, I got it from you. But you know, you had all this hierarchy of needs. And art was after cars and food and clothing. But what we did as a culture, we would buy those things over and over again. So we like, oh, I need a car. It's like, you already got three. So you don't need a car anymore. Keep, you know, keep moving. Finally, this new generation has gotten to the point where they're like, you know, I grew up around all that stuff. I want to put my money on something else. I've been hearing about this art thing. I want to collect art. So as soon as we got into it as the next generation, the art wasn't available anymore. Either A, the galleries wouldn't sell it to you, because they really won't. I mean, I know it sounds crazy and it sounds like that's not true, but I challenge anyone to go to a gallery and try to get an artist that you consider, that you admire, or that you think is really great work. It just won't happen. You can't buy it. You have a waiting list, and the waiting list will never show up, because by the time it does show up, the art is at its peak. It's tripled from the time you first went there to see it, okay? Now, and I want to say something about that. But so, and with the auctions, yeah, it's pricing out because it's not in a collector price range anymore. It's in an investor price range.
But Jumaane, just go back to that point though. Isn't it true that when your dad started the gallery, many of these artists had not established names for themselves? I mean, this was really purely a gut reaction to their work. Many of them have developed names over the years. So isn't it important to find artists and identify artists that you A, like, but B, might have some type of pedigree that might suggest that it's a worthy investment as well, if you're looking at it for investment purposes?
Well, the whole thing is, I never look at it for investing purposes, and ever. Like, I got two Kehinde, that was the only thing I bought for investment purposes. Two Kehinde Wiley sculptures, and I really just did it like fine. I mean, they're like a tchotchke over my stove right now. You know what I mean? Like, oh, I got that. And I got like a picture of like a Batman, you know, bobblehead next to it and this and that. Like, it's just one of those type of items up there now, because it's cool, but I don't look at it like, I don't collect like investment. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to, give me a second here. I'm trying to figure out what I'm, you got me going. Basically, right now, to get art, you have to really zone in and use a keen eye and find somebody young that you can find. Or mid-career is great, too. I think those artists who mid-career, like they may be in their 50s, 60s, because when the people are looking for artists to invest, they're also looking for artists that can control their career. So you have a lot of people who are probably like 50, 60 uh-huh. years old who are just real pure artists, and they've had all this time to create art. That's a great age range. Because for me, it's not about the investment of, okay, let me see their pedigree thing like you're saying and all this, or who's showing them this and the other. Is this person going to continue to work? Is this person going to make art every day for the rest of your life, whether they sell it or not? That's mm-hmm. who you really want to invest in. That's who you really want. And I say invest in. I'm not talking about invest with their art, but invest in them.
Right. Okay?
So that's the era, that's the artist you really want to deal with. Because the other ones, it's not real numbers. I mean, don't get me wrong, we got some great masters who we are still underpriced. So you say like Ed Clark is still underpriced.
Right.
And I say this because his peers are getting 10 times what he's getting.
So for the brand new collector, for the emerging collector to the mid-range collector, which I consider myself, and I tell people, this is my advice, and you know, I know when I'm talking to the Namdis, I gotta have a different filter when I'm talking about art, because that's, like you said, you've come up in that. But I say to people, if you have one piece of art and you have intentions on buying another piece of art, then call yourself a collector, because it's about the intention. You know, it's not about how many pieces you got. You might only have one or two pieces, but you could go around and say you're a collector.
And that's how it is. You're supposed to, you're like, I'm a collector. I get one, I get two, and you look up 10 years later, you got 20 pieces, stuff yeah. like that. Now, you guys have a great artist in Detroit, Rashawn Rucker.
Yeah, yeah.
He's making
a lot of noise.
Say again?
He's making a lot of noise recently.
He is making a lot of noise. We're going to do a show with him in September.
Piper.
For the people who may not know, let's see here.
Yes.
You hear that, Drake?
Yep.
like this is one of his pieces here. So he's incorporating like the pigeons with the black man in terms of like how the pigeons were brought over in the 1600s.
Yes.
And they, when they're brought here, just like the African-American was brought here, or African was brought here, what happens is the pigeons are one bird that they don't migrate. They have nowhere to go. You know, because they're like, I don't even know where I'm from. I ain't from here, but I can't, there's nowhere else for me to go. So then what happens with the pigeons is that they are, people kick at them. They like to get away. You're scum. Throw crumbs at them, eat this, get away. No pigeons allowed. It's like the black man. That's the system. That's the government system, the crumbs. But we're like, look, man, you brought us here, enslaved us, brainwashed us. Now you're mad that we're around. So he's incorporating these pigeons with, so this is one of his pieces here. But like, he's a great artist to collect. Anybody on here who's a young collector or old collector, it don't matter. There are certain artists who are still in tune with what's going on.
Right.
And if I say certain, that don't mean they're the only ones. I mean, they're, because I meet them all the time, I talk to them, and you really get, I get excited. It's like we get this tribe going. Like, you're like, cool, you get it. And I don't show all these people, you know, but at the same time, I respect them or I collect them because I'm like, I like that mentality where people understand the importance of their work and their longevity as artists. Okay. A lot of people don't, a lot of artists don't understand is that you ain't gonna make your best work until you're about 60 years old anyway. Okay? Like, if you really think about it, and somebody can say, hey, you know, I remember I told Rasheed Johnson that, and I remember him saying, man, you know, not that he got mad, but he just got like, no, that ain't true. And I said, okay, fine. Your best work is what you're making right now. And now that sounds even worse, because now that means everything's going downhill for now. You're only 25 years old, right? So I always say your best work is around 60 because you're trying to discover yourself that whole time, being 20s, 30s, 40s. 40s, you finally got a job you're comfortable with, but you're still learning. You're still acting like you know what you're doing, but you really still don't know. Do you really know Excel at that point? Maybe not, you know? It's like, so then by 50, you're getting more there. You're like, oh, I'm a VP. I'm grooved up in my business. I got to stay on that track. You know, I can't make any mistakes, but I kind of know what's going on. By 60, you're the president. And what you know, and what you don't know, and you're fine with it. And you're young enough to want to share. So if somebody comes to you with a question, you're young enough with the energy to talk to them, hang out with, do this and the other, to share. So that's why you make your best work around 60, because at that point in your life, you're like, man, I can do whatever I want to do because I'm good with my skills. Yeah. And then by 70 and 80, you're just doing your thing and you don't bug me. You know what I mean? Leave me alone. So, yeah. You know, but I don't know. But in terms of collecting, real last thing I was thinking about earlier was that I remember in 2009, before I knew about those stock market stuff and all that, I remember there was a big thing about Jay-Z buying a Damien Hirst. And I was like, that don't make sense. Like, how did he get a Damien Hirst? I know he got the money, but I was like, why would they sell him a Damien Hirst? Because the people who own that got a whole network. Okay, they got a big network of billionaires. They don't need a rapper to buy it. And I'm saying rapper because that's what he is to the world. I mean, he's a man, he's his own person. But to the world, you know, you may want Jay-Z to buy something from you or come somewhere because people can say, oh, Jay-Z can. But when you're investing in art and you're like, got billions, you don't need that promotion of Jay-Z because his audience is not your audience.
Right.
Okay? So I knew something was weird when that happened. And you know what happened right after that? And I was telling people about it being weird. But right after that, the stock market crashed. And then right after that, Damien Hirst threw all his art in auction just to cash out. And I was like, you know what? That gallery used Jay-Z to bail them out. It was like a pyramid scheme. You're boosting up prices, keep moving. And the last person holding the thing is the one who loses, right?
Yeah. Hot potato.
Yeah. So that's what happened with it. Now, granted, I'm sure Damien's values may come back and did this and the other. I don't really know. But I knew something was wrong when he got access to something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Hey, well, that's a really good way to look at it. And well, I hope that the trend that's in general, that whereby African-American artists are selling their pieces at more, is something that continues, and that not just because of it's, you know, the value that is externally, it's a measurable value that the world places on it. You know, it's not so much about, I don't think that should be the motivation for people collecting art. But I do think it is important for there to be notable artists that are making, you know, huge sales, just so that we can, I mean, we need to be able to validate ourselves. That there is some benefit in being able to, even if we're not able to personally benefit off of it monetarily, it is great to be able to know that certain artists have sold at certain price points, just so that it lets you know that the wider culture understands its value.
Yeah, but you know what, though? The thing about it is that people are not going to see it, but we still keep putting money as us, like we're still validating ourselves with money.
Yeah.
That's what's wrong. That's why we keep losing, because we think money is worth more than the art.
Right. So
we get money, and we think that's why singers back in the day got nothing for their records in hindsight.
Yeah.
Because they got a Cadillac. They like, I can sing this song all day. I can sing 30 more of these. So yeah. Why wouldn't I take a Cadillac for this thing I created in 5 minutes, this song?
Yeah.
But there's cultures who see the value in the song forever.
Right.
So yes, it sounds good that we make some money. But when this is all gone, the culture is being stolen.
Yeah.
There's no other art form we have control of. None. And the only thing that keeps you relevant in the world is your arts. When you go to war, it's a war crime to bomb the museum. You can't go to war with someone and bomb their museum. You can kill all the people you want. But you bomb the museum, you will go to jail, because that's the real power. At the end of the day, whoever wins that war, they will go get that art, and then they will control the people that are left living with their art. Mm-hmm. So it's bigger than money. Yes, do I want the artist to get what they deserve? Yes, yes, yes. However, we have to understand our whole culture has been monetized. Our culture is just money. And mm-hmm. then when it's bought out, you can't get it back anymore.
Yeah.
Three generations from now, if it keeps going the way it's going now, 3 generations from now, we will not see our art anymore.
Yeah.
Our visual arts are going to be gone.
It says, Patricia Baker, Pat Baker says, any advice to artists who wish to have their art in galleries? And I guess I can answer this question, but I'll let you answer it. And what is needed?
Any advice to artists who want to have their art in galleries? And what is needed, right? Well, what's needed? First of all, gallery and artist is kind of like a marriage per se, okay? So one thing I always say is that really just research all the different galleries that and what they represent, what they show. Because a lot of times, and that doesn't mean like, hey, I'm doing watercolor nudes, let me find a gallery who has watercolor nudes and maybe they want me. Because maybe they say, hey, you know, it's kind of close to the other artists I have with the same style, I don't know. But really find a gallery that has that represents your style or your type of art or your energy even. I mean, that's very important, like a marriage. So what happens is, you gotta build relationships with these different galleries. One thing I can tell you right now, don't go to a gallery with your portfolio and say, you wanna see my art. Now, I will look at it. A lot of people come to me and I do it, and then they'll say, wow, you're the first person to look at it. Everybody else told me to no, you need an appointment and no. So I don't even want you to have to deal with that kind of stress of that, because then people take it personally. Artists, it's like your life is right here in this bag, and the people are telling you to get out. You're like, what? you know, want to fight somebody, right? It's like showing your picture of your kid to somebody and they say, no, I'm not looking at no babies. You're like, what? You know, it's offensive. But what I would say to do is still go to those galleries, but build relationships, be friends, meet the people, meet all the different galleries that you think are potential, go to them, meet the people, go to their exhibitions, feel the energy out. Because just because you have a gallery don't mean it's going to work for you. You could end up at a gallery and your work's just in their storage all forever. Mm-hmm. That's not helping you either. So you want to go somewhere, and based upon your time and your career and where you are, you want to go find a small gallery, somewhere where you might be one of the few artists they have, so they could just spend their time focused on you, making sure that you're on the wall all the time, because they're like, wait, I only got five artists, and I like your work, so you're my anchor artist. Like, Ed Clark was for my father. Ed Clark was like his guy, helped him hang shows. They were like, they had a relationship. Mm-hmm. So you really want that kind of relationship where, because your goal right now is just for people to see your work.
Yeah.
Gagosian could say, fine, I'll take you.
Yeah.
You're back in the back for 10 years. That didn't help you at all. You really want to be somewhere where they're really promoting you, pushing you, and have your interest in mind. Huh?
Somebody who believes in you and who's in alignment with you philosophically.
Yeah. Yeah.
We end pretty promptly at 12:30 every time we do this. We've come up on the bewitching hour. But before we end, I unmuted your dad because I just wanted to give him an opportunity to say something. So, GR, I don't know if you want to come in and give a couple of parting words before we wrap this up.
Hey, let me ask you this. Can I share something while he's talking?
Absolutely.
All right, cool.
I'm proud of my son and his presentation, but I'm also very happy to see all the number of people who are interested in art and on this call or on this meeting today. I think it's really refreshing to see you all. And Patricia, I would like to see that painting that's behind you. But I just think it's warm. It's heartwarming to see everybody out here listening to this and participating in this program. And Priscilla, it's good to see you. Okay. Priscilla, if you don't know, that's Drake's mother, and she's also a very, very good artist. Bye, everybody. Oh, no, mind you taking over. Okay, absolutely.
Oh, I was just showing you, showing part of your collection.
This is Charles Alston here. That's Romare Bearden. You may need to move a little faster because
That's better.
Chikaya Booker, Frank Bowling.
Yeah, Frank Bowling, started working with him in the 90s. Yeah. Carol Ann Carter.
Yeah.
Nene Carter. Ed Clark. Robert Cole Scott. I remember Robert Cole Scott used to say, because his paintings were like about 35,000, 40,000. And Kehinde was on the scene. He was getting 100-something thousand. I said, Robert, you know, you got to make your paintings more. He said, look, I want every black person got a luxury car, so I'm going to make the price of a luxury car so that way they can choose.
Mm-hmm. Lovely.
Yeah, yeah.
Rasheed Johnson here.
Agent, I see. Head and nominee in charge. Stop. This is one of my first paintings. I bought this painting in 1968, and I became so proud of it that I was a junior in college when I bought that painting.
Wow. Yep. You know what? We have Emar Hutchins on the phone. Emar actually did. If you back up, go back. Right there, Emar did a tribute piece to Jacob Lawrence, and he's on the line now. I want you to see his piece later on. But I just wanted to put a note there because it is a wonderful.
This Al Loving. See, this is one of his bigger pieces where he was trying to work with perspective. And then his whole thing was, instead of going back, how do I go forward? So that's where you see like the swirls later on that kind of go forward. It's one of his cubes.
Yeah, these are excellent.
So this is what I just grew up around, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yep.
So how do you, you know, it's like, shit, you just look at that every day. It's kind of like, hey, we'll figure it out. There he is. Boom.
All right. Hey,
all right.
Thank you, Jumaane. Thank you.
Y'all. Hope y'all had a good time. Raise your hand if I was okay.
I'll unmute everybody's mic so that everybody can.
All right. Well,
yeah, let's unmute everybody.
There you go. Thank you for the thumb up and the clap.
Okay.
Hey, Taki.
Yeah.
Hey, Taki.
I enjoyed it.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Lovely.
This was fun. Good.
Yeah, very good, man. Very good.
Thank you. My daughter says, she says, I'm an artist. She was doing something the other day, and she was painting. And I said, you got to be an artist to do this. Then, well, all right.
I love it. Oh, man, Nataki is totally innovative. And my mother has a great collection, awesome collection. Ann Hernandez has been on every one of these calls. Ann, you are the real deal. She says, every time I attend these studios, I'm beyond inspired, moved, and challenged. So, thank you for continuing that tradition.
I appreciate you. This was fun, guys. Well, hey, I'm going to be the last one here, so y'all hang up as y'all feel. Talking or not, it don't matter, but I'm not going to leave before y'all, okay? I'm just going to stick right here.
And if you want to, if somebody's still on and they want to talk, just unmute. We'll keep it on, but we're wrapping up now, so if you want to hang up, please feel free to. And if you want to come on board and talk, unmute your mic.
Oh man, that was fun, man.
Thank you, everyone.
Whew. It was very good, Drake.
Yeah, thank you all. Yeah, this is excellent. You all are excellent. Hey, Sharita.
Hey, little Nataki.
Yeah. Where is Nataki? I didn't see her.
There she is.
Hey, Nataki.
This girl looks like my sister down here. I keep seeing
Oh, down here.
I see her.
All right, y'all take care. Have a good one.
All right, cool.
Okay. Now.
Drake, give me a call.
Love your hair.
All right, okay.
Yeah, we got to get that. That's that Taki style. We got to get Taki with that.
Mom, your mic is off if you're saying something. We can't hear you.
It's all right. I still feel the energy. One more time. Unmic it one more time. Try it. Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Oh, Drake, it said that you were doing that. You had me muted. You didn't want me to say anything.
No.
Player hater.
Hey, Jumaane.
Yes, ma'am.
So is your, a very good presentation, is your gallery open during this time, anytime? Are you going,
what are you doing? No, I'm not open. I'm going to have a virtual show, Gregory Goss. Well, yes, he's behind me the whole time. I was like, the next show, Gregory Coates, right? After all that, I didn't show who I'm showing next. But it's cool. I'm gonna, because I used to do these virtual tours anyway, the gallery, you know? And what I'm going to do is do a little virtual thing, and then people can come in for an appointment. Like, I had a client came in yesterday, you know, just picked up a piece, but it was like, yeah, everybody had their mask. There's only two people had a mask on. I got two people want to come by later today. Well, you know, I'm not in no rush to have a lot of people in here. Mm-hmm. And I'm, you know, no rush at all, really. But I do want to hang up a show because part of this progressive art brunch, it's about 12 galleries out here. Mm-hmm.
Like a gallery crawl?
It's like, yeah, gallery crawl. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Gallery crawl. But every gallery has like a little bite to eat, you know? So what I want to do is we're going to do that, but we've been doing it virtually. So I'm going to get ready for that. But other than that, I'm taking it slow.
Yeah, I see you. Hey, I see you having fun. I follow you on Facebook. I'm cool.
I'm like, because I'm still working online. I mean, a lot of people, I'm getting a lot of calls and I'm working.